Mark didn't know what to do, so he just went to Rachel and said, hey, I got this strange email from Kevin. It hurts your stalker. And Rachel kind of made light of it and said, oh, just ignore that guy. John didn't make light either, so Mark just ignored it. And then the next day, Mark brought the chat room, Rachel was there. Now, Rachel always logged in at the same time. Mark did, John was very rare.
She was needed to be there.
And so Mark asked John, talked to Rachel today. And then Mark was in the main chat, and he asked them there, and they said, Rachel or Mark,
and they said,
that's when Mark went into his email, and he had another message. This message again was about Rachel. This time, Kevin is saying he actually has Rachel hostage. And the only way he's going to release her is if Mark lets Kevin look at his feet. Again, that's what took.
And so Mark, interestingly, does not go to the police. He doesn't tell anyone about this.
He just says, hey, I'll do that. And so he lets him see his feet. And then Evan writes back saying, okay, I've released Rachel. Later that day,
Rachel came back online, and thanked Mark for what he did. She felt really mad that he had to be kind of humiliated in a way. She said, you know what, I really need to see each other face to face. I want to apologize to you.
And so they decide the next day, they're going to meet up finally in town. But the next day, when Mark went to London, Rachel didn't show.
In fact, after this meeting,
Rachel never contacted Mark again. When Mark got back to the computer, he asked John to talk to Rachel, and he said no. And he went into the chat room and searched around, and no one ever heard from Rachel. A couple of days later, after the rumor passed around the main chat room about how apparently one of the members of this chat room didn't kill another member of the chat room. Mark thinks himself, no, can't be. But almost immediately after the rumor was announced, the main chat room started to chime in to say that they could be Kevin, the guy who writes the pink, the guy who owns Stalker, and Rachel, because they both logged out at the same time and had not logged back in. The only ones in the chat room at that time. Then after that, dozens of users commented, this was actually true, that Kevin had indeed heard about Rachel's reality, just kind of crashed out. He feels so guilty that he probably could have done something to stop this. But then interestingly, even though Mark was devastated, just crushed by what's happened, he just continued to log into the chat room and acted like nothing had happened. John picked up on this strange behavior, and began to delicately ask Kevin when you're looking. Okay, but Mark later, over time, the rumor about what happened to Rachel and Kevin just kind of left the chat room, and it seemed like a little more. Over the next month, John and Mark's relationship really strengthened. They continued to speak in private chat, now missing Rachel, so they're interacting with each other, and they began meeting in person, hanging out in real life. About a month after Rachel's disappearance, a new person popped up, a woman named Janet, all capital, and she reached out to Mark. She said to Mark that she was married, 44 years old. She was real estate agent, secretly she was his spy, and she was contacted by Mark because she was sending proof. She told Mark if he agreed to work with her, not only would he become an agent, but he would become a fantasy wealthy and he could be a boyfriend. Now, of course, to an adult, this sounds preposterous. It sounds like a scam. But you got to remember, Mark at this time was extremely lonely. He's just lost his girlfriend. He's still stuck in the law. And he's just not a great person. He's kind of trying to take advantage.
And she was promising all the things he wanted in life: status, money, romance.
And so even though he didn't necessarily believe everything Janet was saying, he wanted to hurt her, so he went along with it.
He did not tell John about his interactions with Janet, perhaps signaling that he didn't fully believe it, and he didn't care about the details.
But as soon as Mark told Janet he was prepared to work with her, he made him swear an oath through the chat, and then told him he would need to go to London for initiation, where he'd be meeting the Queen amongst other dignitaries and officials. At this point, Mark asked a couple of questions, namely, how would I explain to my mom that I was just suddenly leaving for a couple of days, a week, school. I have to give a reason for it.
And she would say, your mother will be disciplined once you go to London for initiation, will be in touch with her progress reports on you, and you'll have two opportunities every day to call.
Feeling satisfied that this wasn't a fact, okay, you know, you go.
She says, well, there's a caveat. You have to pass a series of tests before you're going to be allowed to go to initiation.
This is where Janet explained to Mark why he specifically was recruited.
She said his friend John was actually not named John, his real name was James Bell,
and he was a very, very important person.
She couldn't say why until he passed this test. And so Mark's very confused by this, and he says, okay, what's this test? She says, well, you need to demonstrate that you can protect your friend James Bell, and so I want you to escort him from his school to his dentist appointment tomorrow.
You're going to be his bodyguard for one day, but he can't let him know you're his bodyguard. He can't know that you know his real identity. So if you can do that successfully, get back. I will explain to you why he is so important.
At this point, Mark is very committed to this, so he says, yep, do it. He reaches out to John that day and says, hey, can you hang out? John tells him, yeah, that's a dentist appointment at school, so you'll be at that. Mark says, oh, great, you're at the dentist appointment. John's like, great, so the next day, Mark meets up with John, aka James Bell, and he walks with him from school to the dentist appointment, and he doesn't do anything suspicious, so he doesn't need to do any bodyguard duties.
And after the dentist appointment, the two of them just go along and spend the rest of the day together. Once Mark got back to his house and opened the computer, there was a message waiting for him from Janet, and the message said, we have agents following you, you did a great job, you passed the test.
Now I can tell you why James Bell, working with John, is so very important. And she told him that at the bottom of the Atlantic Ocean is a big safe, only a couple of countries know about, and inside of that safe is 568 billion pounds. And it belongs to the Queen, but only one person has access to that safe. And that person is James Bell.
Literally, his body would be to be in front of the safe for its special scanner to scan him, recognize it as James Bell, and then it would open its door.
Despite its impossibility, Mark believed this was real.
Not so much because he naturally believed the safe at the bottom of the Atlantic Ocean was real, but it was because he totally believed Janet was real.
Janet had the ability to know what he was wearing, where he had gone that day, what he was up to, and seemed to know everything about him. And it's because she told him she has agents monitoring him all the time, disguised as bus drivers, teachers, mailmen, that basically he was on constant surveillance. And she explained to him that that's what happens when you're recruited. So when Janet gave Mark his final test, despite how shocked Mark was, what he had to do, he was willing to do it because he really believed he was doing it for the government.
The test was simple. Mark needed to kill John, aka James Bell.
And she explained to him that James Bell actually had a brain tumor. And if a long country found out about this, they could steal his body after he died, and they could use his body to gain access to the safe. So we need to preemptively end his life, take control of his body, and get him back safe. She told Mark if he completed the test, he would move on to the initiation, and he would get his paycheck, and he would officially become James' boyfriend.
Mark is so deep at this point, he is fully committed and says, yes, I'm prepared to do this. She says, okay, your name is agent 4769. We need to go by a large number.
She said there was going to be a code for this test, which is going to be 6969.
At the same point, he was able to say that on the day he was supposed to carry out this attack, Captain James Bell met by a bus station and transport. Mark told John down the alleyway that Janet had been dressed as a detective, and she was sure he would be the first people to arrive at the scene. She was dressed as a detective, and she was sure he would be dressed as a detective. And so once he was positioned, Mark grabbed John's shoulder, pulled out his knife, and subbed up him. When the police arrived, Janet was not there. Mark, after giving a statement on what happened, asked the police officers, when's Janet going to be here?
No one knew what he was talking about. After John survived the attack and said Mark was the one who attacked him, Mark would tell police, you've got to find Janet.
She's the one who can explain what's going on here.
But Janet never arrived because Janet didn't exist. Neither did Rachel. Neither did Kevin.
Neither did James Bell.
Neither did 189 other accounts that Mark interacted with on a daily basis
inside of Chapwizard.
And all of those big accounts were determined to be controlled by one person.
And that one person is just
When John was confronted with all these confiscated chat logs that clearly showed he was behind all of these accounts,
he confessed.
John said he never entered this chat in order to do any of the things he did or to manipulate Mark.
He said when he joined,